those of you who don't know, I'm Vicar Jared, and I'm joined by Pastor Myron Seminary and Luke. And as you can tell, we have a very special worship service today because we have the Sound of Music to help us work. Great God. Wow, you guys, are we good? I'm keeping you guys awake, that's all. We'll be starting with our opening hymn.
From our sinful condition. Together as his people, let's take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life.
Almighty God, merciful Father, in holy baptism you declared us to be your children and gathered us into your one holy church in which you daily and richly forgive us all our sins and grant us new life through your Spirit. Be in our midst, enliven our faith, and graciously receive our prayer and praise through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in this stand, by the command of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy. Be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. May be seated for the word of the Lord.
Our epistle reading this morning comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. I want you to know, brothers, that our fathers were all under the cloud, and all passed through the sea, and all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, with most of them, God was not pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things took place as examples for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. Do not be idolaters as some of them were, as it is written, "The people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play." We must not indulge in sexual immorality as some of them did, and 23,000 fell in a single day. We must not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and were destroyed by serpents, nor grumble, as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example, but they were written down for our instruction, on whom the end of the ages has come. Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed, lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape, that you may be able to endure it. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We continue with the anthem. Please rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. There were some present at that very time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And he answered them, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Or those 18 on whom the tower in Siloam fell and killed them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish." And he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came seeking fruit on it and found none. And he said to the vine dresser, "Look, for 3 years now I have come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and I find none. Cut it down. Why should it use up the ground?" And he answered him, "Sir, let it alone this year also, until I dig around it and put on manure. Then if it should bear fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We now confess our common Christian faith today in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated for our sermon hymn.
of students, right? Yes. Although looking at them, I think we have a different group of band members from last night. Because last night they all had nice suits and dresses. Now they're dressed to what? To leave us. Couldn't you wait just a few more hours and be with us for the, what's that next service? Whatever it is. And the bus will wait for you, okay? That reminds me of the bus trips we used to take when I was youth pastor here years and years ago with our high school choir Sunshine Celebration. How many of you remember that, right? So, yeah, a lot of you guys do. Well, thank you. I think that's when our oldest alumni, Sunshine, did clap. So, anyway, our sermon is based on our Old Testament lesson from Jeremiah. Lamentations, rather, written by Jeremiah. It's in the last chapter, chapter 5, and all of the chapters in Lamentations are poems, and they're poems of lament, complaining to God about the present situation in which everything seemed to be hopeless. Now, in chapters 1, 2, and 4, I believe, the first Hebrew word that begins is a word that's always used whenever there was a funeral dirge. Now, this last poem, in which our text is found in chapter 5, is not like the other ones, which were acrostic, which means that the first sentence always began with a different letter of the Hebrew alphabet. You following me? Well, this last chapter doesn't have that style. Probably because the raw emotions that were being expressed could not be expressed in a stylized form. And so we turn to our Old Testament lesson from Lamentations, the 5th chapter, where we read, "Remember, O Lord, what has befallen us. Look and see our disgrace. Our inheritance has been turned over to strangers, our homes to foreigners. We have become orphans, fatherless. Our mothers are like widows. We must pay for the water we drink. The wood we get must be bought. Our pursuers are at our necks. We are weary. We are given no rest. We have given the hand to Egypt and to Assyria to get bread enough. Our fathers sinned and are no more, and we bear their iniquities. Slaves rule over us. There is none to deliver us from their hand. We get our bread at the peril of our lives because of the sword in the wilderness. Our skin is hot as an oven with the burning heat of famine. Women are raped in Zion, young women in the towns of Judah. Princes are hung up by their hands. No respect is shown to the elders. Young men are compelled to grind at the mill, and boys stagger under loads of wood. The old men have left the city gate, the young men their music. The joy of our hearts has ceased. Our dancing has been turned to mourning. The crown has fallen from our head. Woe to us, for we have sinned. For this our heart has become sick. For these things our eyes have grown dim. From Mount Zion, which lies desolate, jackals prowl over it. But you, O Lord, reign forever. Your throne endures to all generations. Why do you forget us forever? Why do you forsake us for so many days? Restore us to yourself, O Lord, that we may be restored. Renew our days as of old, unless you have utterly rejected us and you remain exceedingly angry with us." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Nobody could say at that time in Jerusalem, 586, 587 BC, nobody could say, well, you know, things could be worse, because things could not have been worse. It was a hopeless situation. Again, 586, 587, the Babylonian Empire under King Nebuchadnezzar had destroyed the earthly dwelling place of God, namely Solomon's temple. The city of Jerusalem was in ruins. It was utter chaos. Reminds me of those pictures that you and I have seen of Ukraine, right? Those bombed out cities. It was like that in Jerusalem, maybe only worse, if you can believe that. And so there didn't seem to be a happy ending for them. Unless God was no longer angry with them. But there's not much hope in that in that verse. It's not like those Hallmark movies. When I'm watching TV at home, and there's nothing good on, and I still want to watch TV, I'm ashamed to say that I turn to a Hallmark movie. Now, you know about those movies, right? That boy meets girl, or vice versa. They fall in love. They fall out of love. They fall back in love again, and they live how? Oh, you watch a Hallmark movie, and you know the ending. You know the ending. They're going to live happily ever after. Jeremiah doesn't know the ending. He thinks he does. The ending is hopeless. It's hopeless. Things could not be worse. And yet there's an element of hope. First of all, in the 19th verse where we read that, perhaps, O Lord, you can renew us as days of old, a hopeless situation. Much like our world, right? We have a fallen world and a falling world. And Dr. William Schumacher, who's a professor at St. Louis Seminary, in charge of the Institute for Mission Studies, he wrote the following about our world. And I think it's very descriptive when he says, the idea that things fall apart has become irresistibly contemporary, echoed repeatedly by our century's crescendo of violent evil. Crescendo of violent evil. All we have to do is look at the invasion, the Russian invasion of the Ukraine. You see children and mothers killed by the missiles and by the bombs. We see these hundreds and hundreds of thousands of refugees with no place to go. No place to go. No home. Everything destroyed. You realize we're already over the threshold of 6 million people killed by the virus. Another strain about to come on our horizon. Things are terribly amiss in our world and even in our church. What about our neighborhood? In St. Louis, we read that children, not daily, but almost monthly, are gunned down, killed in their homes, on the street, in their yard. And it used to be there was a street creed that you did not kill women or children. Now, nobody pays attention to that. You get that person before that person gets you. Something is terribly amiss in our world, in our society. Can't even get Republicans and Democrats agree on one simple thing that would be good for the country. Something is terribly wrong with our society. My wife and I decided some time ago that we were going to give a monthly contribution, a monthly donation to St. Jude's Hospital. You've probably seen those commercials. You see children who have no hair, children who have deformities, children who can't walk, and your heart goes out to them. Something's terribly wrong in our world. Now, thanks be to St. Jude, a lot of these children survive, but a lot of them don't. And what about in our own lives? Aren't there situations that make us wonder about the care of God and the love of God? All of us encounter, or our families encounter, those kinds of situations that we feel are hopeless. And yet, in our text, there's a couple of things that do give us hope. First of all, we read in the first verse that, Lord, you remember who we are, that we are yours. Jeremiah wants God to remember something. What has befallen us, asked Jeremiah to God. It's not like Jeremiah doesn't think that God doesn't know what had happened to them. No, whenever the Israelites asked God to remember something, what they wanted God to remember was his covenant promise with them, that they would always be his people, that he would always be with them. It's like the covenant God makes with us in holy baptism, claimed by God here in time and for all eternity. Listen to this covenant promise that God made with Israel in 2 Samuel chapter 7. I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. When he commits iniquity, I will discipline him. But my steadfast love will not depart from him. And your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. And there's another key in our text for hope for Israel. But you, O Lord, reign forever. Your throne endures to all generations. We are in your hands, O God. You reign, you are in control for us. So hope in distressful times, hope in the midst of distress is twofold. First of all, trusting the promises of God. And the psalmist says that God always keeps his promises. And number two, the confident truth that God, the sovereign, loving God, is in control of the world and of our lives. First of all, our faith and our hope rest upon God's promises. And the chief promise is, in the midst of the worst tragedy of all, death, the promise of Jesus, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes me, though he die, yet shall he live. Whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. There's also that promise that in every situation of life, pain, anguish, or what have you, we have a God who is for us. That promise in Romans chapter 8, where St. Paul writes, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Jesus is not only for us on that hellish cross, but after the resurrection, he is with us. All the promises of God for us are true, and all the promises of God for us are nailed to that cross and written upon that empty tomb. Listen, be acquainted in the word of God with the promises of God. He'll never leave you or forsake you. He's just far from you, only far away is a prayer. His grace will sustain you. He can build our lives, our hope on these promises of God, that he will never leave us, he will never fail us. And the second hope, or the second aspect of hope, is based on the sovereignty of God for us, where Jeremiah writes, but you, O Lord, reign forever. Your throne endures to all generations. As someone has said, hope means hoping when things are hopeless. Or as an American poet once said, be joyful, even when you consider the facts. You know, one Old Testament theologian said that the Israelites, in spite of the terrible suffering over the centuries, the Israelites never had a pessimistic view of life. Even the gloomiest of the writers of the Old Testament, Ecclesiastes, you know the guy that says, vanity, vanity, all is vanity? Even he says, enjoy life, eat, drink, and be merry. Could they have that hopeful attitude where not for the fact that they knew that God was a sovereign God in control of all of their lives and control of all life for them? I think so. It's like this man that was walking in his neighborhood, he came across a little league baseball game. He sat to watch the game. He sat by the dugout. There was a little boy in the dugout. He asked that little boy, how you doing? What's the score? And the boy says, well, it's 18-0, and we're behind. And I said, well, aren't you disappointed? And the guy said, no. The boy said, no, we haven't even come up with that yet. You see, hope is based on situations outside of that situation. Hope is based on the promises of God and the fact that God is in control of our lives. Another promise of Romans chapter 8 is, God works everything out together for good, everything, for those who love God, who have been called according to his purpose. Everything in our lives, God works out for our eternal good. Dear friends in Christ, in the midst of distress, we have the promises of God and the truth that God is in control of our lives. We know the ending, and it's a happy ending, that one day, because of the cross and the empty tomb, one day we will live happily forever in the new heaven and the new earth. Now that doesn't mean that we don't cry during the sad parts. It means that during those sad parts, we remember that God is in control. His promises we can always count on to sustain us, and he's in control of our lives. Even when things fall apart, Jesus is always, always with us and for us. In his name, amen. In 1989, Now may the peace of God that passes understanding guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Concerns. We pray for Polly Geertz, who is going to have surgery on March 23rd, as well as prayer thanksgiving for Sandy Podner, who is now home from the hospital and she is recovering well. We also pray for another prayer celebration. Tim and Cindy Tweedy are celebrating 34 years of marriage, which is an incredible blessing. We pray for Audrey Welch, the stepmom of Walt Welch, who's been diagnosed with cancer. For Brian Keister, for rotator cuff surgery on the 21st of this month. We also pray for Greg Newell, the brother of Becky Smith, who's diagnosed with cancer. And we pray for the family of Marge Wooten, a friend of Tim and Cindy, who passed away in her sleep last night. Please rise. Almighty God, you order and number our days according to your wisdom. Give us repentant hearts, lest we perish with this world of violence and suffering, that we would hold fast to Christ for life and salvation. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but desire that they would turn and live. Give pastors courage to warn of sin and death. Give all Christians strength to defend that message. Turn sinners to life by the proclamation of Christ, who delivers from all unrighteousness. Bless all those who are called into service in your church and guide our call processes for a family ministry pastor and a principal. We thank you for the gift of music today in our worship service and ask your blessing and protection on the Lake Country Lutheran High School band as they travel and share you through their music. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, guard your people against immorality. Grant that our homes would be havens of godly instruction and chastity, and fill marriages with fidelity and love. We pray for all Zion's household, and especially this week, for James and Tiffany Brooks and family, Raymond and Mary Brown, Larry and Barb Bruce, Michael and Jamie Bruce and family, Robert and Stephanie Bruce and family, Doug and Sherry Brooke, Jared and Carolyn Brynildsen, Brian and Barbie Brynildsen, Pat and Liz Buchanan and family, Sarah Buckley and family. Lord, in your mercy. God of all, you establish justice, not through the desires of sinners, but by your law, which is for all. Enlighten the authorities of this and every nation, that they might rule justly for true good. Bring peace to all nations, and especially now to Ukraine. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Lord, remember your people who cry to you for mercy in a world where towers fall and sinners work evil. Deliver those in need of healing and comfort. We pray for the family of Marge Wooten, for Ben Deering, for Paula Geertz, Sandy Podner, Joan Berry, Carl Frankfurt, Hilmer Shanebaum, Ken Ray, Janice Moore, Ray Brown, Ruth Henderson, Cheryl Bedner, Ted Betcher, Meredith Fowler, Bob Ringering, Wendy Osborne, Dorothy Asbury, Danny Wiesman, Myron Bollinger, Dolly Meininger, Tiffany Lubinsky, Kathy Sawyer, Bob Schaefer, Anime Shanebaum, Audrey Welch, Brian Keister, Greg Newell, Brooke Carden, Ray Hiller, Bernadine Liefer, Tim Blaza, Jennifer Withrow, Gary Poe, Diana Bertels, Karen Atberry, Tony Goforth, Sandra Greenberg, Holly Johnson, Dora Schoburn, David Knobloch, Jack Morton, Robert Guthrie, Jim Edwards, Bobby Cummins, Julie Morrow, Gordon and Shirley Abbott, Mary MD, Daryl Bertels, Pam Voyle, Steve Dorr, Dave Tainer, Nancy Dorr, Janet Pickering, Annie Radcliffe, Buzz Kindle, Alex Geertz, Luke Millard, Renee White, Shirley Jones, Collette Sawyer, Christy Morris, Coy Chafin, Heidi Reynolds, Rita Pickard, Brian Hale, Missy Wiesman, David Wilson, Levi Gott, Tegan Davis Holt, Cecil Thomason, Jim Woolsey, and Diane Soretto, and strengthen them to look to you for help in their time of affliction. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of life, you have brought us into your vineyard and appointed us to bear good fruit. Receive our thanks for your patience and grant that we would show your love and grace in all that we say and do. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, you are the source of all blessings. You bestow upon us so many great gifts, none greater than the relationships you place in our lives. We pray a prayer of thanksgiving for the blessed marriage of Tim and Cindy Tweedy for their 34 years. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you led your people Israel through the sea and fed them in the wilderness until you delivered them to the promised land. You also have faithfully enlivened your people with Christ by means of holy baptism and holy communion. Receive our thanks for your kindness to the saints who now rest from their labors, and sustain us by your means of grace until you deliver us also to heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Before we begin before we get to the Lord's Supper, I do have one announcement that I forgot to mention at the beginning. As you can tell, we have a special service here, and due to that, we are going to be changing up the way we do communion. Most of you know that we usually stand on each side, and you come down in a line, and we have a continuous stream that way. Today, instead, though, we will be having these individual bread and wine cups. We're going to come down in rows and pass these trays through the pews. If you're communing with us, please take one of those. Don't open it right away. Once everybody has one, then we will commune as a group. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
mercy on us and given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. At your command, Abraham prepared to offer his son Isaac as a sacrifice on the mountain. Yet in mercy you provided a ram as a substitute. We give you thanks that on Calvary you spared not your only Son, but sent him to offer his life as a ransom for many. As we eat and drink his body and blood, grant us, like Abraham our father, to trust in your promise now fulfilled in Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, will be done, as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner, also after supper, he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the remission of all your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. may be seated for the distribution. Obviously, with the white at the bottom. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, given in death for the forgiveness of all of your sins. And then when ready, take and drink. This is the true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, shed for you for the remission of all your sins. One term for this meal is Holy Communion, and so it's kind of fitting this morning that as a fellowship of the Holy Christian Church that we do commune at the same time together. Now may this true body and true blood of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you in that true faith that leads to life everlasting. Depart in his love and for his service. Amen. Please stand for the Nunc Dimittis, if able.
Oh,
Glad to see you all here for worship. Let's give another round of applause to our So we welcome them as well. For those of you who don't know, this is the Lake Country Lutheran High School Band. Their director Becky Garlock, and a couple chaperones, their principal, is here. In fact, I'd like to invite the principal up just to give a few words.
Good morning. I'm Catherine Pagans, principal at Lake Country Lutheran High School, and thank you so much for having us here today. We were here last night as well for the service, and we were able to do a little concert after the service, and your congregation has been so welcoming to us. Actually served all of these kids dinner last night as well, which was awesome. So thank you so much for your hospitality and for taking care of us as we're on tour. We're on the fifth day of our tour, and it's the final day. We actually pack things up and head back to Wisconsin this afternoon. So these kids have been amazing. It's been awesome to have their music shared with others as we've been to Springfield and St. Louis and Collinsville and all sorts of different places. So it's been really an exciting adventure for the kids. So as we go through the tour, these students have had an opportunity to actually express the mission of Lake Country Lutheran High School. And our mission is to share Jesus, shape lives, and develop leaders. And what's really awesome as they share their music is that they're sharing Jesus through that music. They're also shaping lives, the lives of themselves and the lives of others, as people hear that music and enjoy it with them. And they're also developing their leadership skills as they go through this experience of being on tour. All the work that goes into this, all the loading and unloading, they each have special jobs that they have to do, and it's awesome to see them step up and accomplish those things and really fulfill their roles as we go through this. And it's awesome that Mrs. Becky Garlock gives them those experiences, because it's a lot of work, but it's really cool to see the kids step up and do that. So Lake Country Lutheran High School started 23 years ago with 5 students, and now we have 349 students 23 years later. We've had a couple different locations that we've been in, and about 12, 13 years ago we moved into our permanent facility, and a couple years ago we outgrew that and had to add on to that facility. And one of the additions that was part of that was to have a dedicated performing arts center. So these students specifically get a chance to glorify God in that specific performing arts center. And it's been such a blessing. They are so amazing, sharing their talents and skills with others and sharing Jesus through that music. So we hope that you have enjoyed that experience. We are so thankful that you have welcomed us to be here and the hospitality that you have shown us. And I believe we have one last song for the postlude here before we finish up. And if you feel so moved, I've heard that there will be an offering basket separate from the regular offering basket in the back. And if you'd like to support our ministry, you're welcome to do that. Thank you so much.
We do have an elder standing in the back. If you'd like to be part of the free will offering, that basket will be for that. We do have our normal 2 baskets, one for guest slips and one for normal Sunday offerings. Next up for announcements, we're looking for somebody to manage the receipt and care of the Easter lilies this year. So if you feel so inclined and would like to volunteer in that way, feel free to call the office. Kelly can give you some details as to how that'll work. We'd love to have you lend a hand. It's a great way to serve the church. And then lastly, if you would like to buy Easter lilies yourself, they'll be $11, and you can submit that payment with your sentiments to the church office, or you can put it with the offering. And that information is going to be in the bulletin next week. And as we said, there will be one more song, so if you'd like to stick around and hear one last great song. I know I will be doing the same. Feel free. Blessings on your day, everybody.